30 years ago when I wrote The Belarus Secret, the Justice Department and other agencies censored the heck out of it. And now, 30 years later, you know, I'm free to write about it. And they've sort of walked into their own trap. They wouldn't have censored this stuff out of my book 30 years ago unless it was true. And now they can't deny it. It's funny, my book came out on Veterans Day in November, and 3 days later, the Justice Department leaked a 600-page report to the New York Times, you know, apologizing, justifying their efforts, and admitting that, in fact, yeah, the U.S. government, okay, did recruit some Nazis, and we might have lied about some stuff to the courts. But the idea was that before a single review could be written about my book, they wanted to get their story out and plead to the misdemeanor because they knew I was going to charge them with the felony. There are people in the Justice Department who belong in prison. They lied to Congress. They orchestrated one fraud after another. And this isn't just, you know, one little episode. This is something that goes back to the 1920s. The Justice Department was protecting those great American families who funded Hitler. Teddy Roosevelt banned monopolies, trusts, and cartels in America. The Webb-Pomeroy Act of 1918 allowed American corporations, the robber barons of Wall Street, to set up monopolies, trusts, and cartels overseas. So these crooked companies bought three countries. They funded the infant Nazi Party of Germany, the infant Bolshevik Party of Russia, and what became the House of Saud. Basically, they funded three terrorist groups to take control of three countries that would allow them to set up their monopolies, trusts, and cartels. This is both Republicans and Democrats. Remember the Truman-Dewey race? Well, Dewey's campaign manager in New York was Alan Dulles. And Dulles had been promised by Dewey as soon as he won, Dulles would head up a new agency to be called the CIA. Dulles had already started hiring his buddy, his buddies. His Dulles's idea was to cover up his client's Nazi investments under a shroud of national security. Big problem when Truman got reelected. So for a while, they actually had two CIAs, one that worked for the President Truman and the Democratic Party, and the other, called the Office of Policy Coordination, OPC, that worked for the Republicans and Alan Dulles. And for 4 years, we had two CIAs in America, one that hunted Nazis, one that recruited them. And things got worse when Eisenhower was elected, because Eisenhower put the Dulles brothers in charge of everything. One brother became head of CIA, the other became head of the State Department. And they just turned the faucet and let the Nazi war criminals come into America by the droves. Now, the worst thing they did was to bring in the Arab Nazis. Boy, there's a scandal and a half. My first boss at this new Nazi hunting unit that President Carter set up was a guy who had been one of the banker's prosecutors at Nuremberg. His name was Walter Rockler. He's now passed away. But Walter told me that the Nuremberg trials were fixed, that something had gone on. And so my secret assignment from him was to find out what had happened. Who had fixed the Nuremberg trials and why? And, you know, what I found out was this whole history of, you know, the Wall Street robber barons and how they got involved. So it was, I wore two hats. Officially, I was investigating Belarusian Nazis in America, but they were just a case study and a cover-up for my real job, which is to find out, you know, how the American investors got their money into Nazi Germany and got it out again. What Roosevelt wanted to do was to use the bankers' trial to have the German bankers point the fingers at their American partners. And then that would cause a public outcry, and Roosevelt could put the American robber barons on trial for aiding the Nazis for treason. Giving aid and comfort to the enemy in time of war is treason. And Roosevelt had more than the two witnesses the Constitution required. He had hundreds of witnesses. In fact, there were 150 Americans who had worked inside the Third Reich all during the war on behalf of American companies. And Dulles had to hide them. So they set up a special prison camp called Ashcan Dustbin after the war, and they hid the Americans, traitors, who worked for the American companies, in that camp, and eventually the Justice Department quietly released them all and brought them home. Not a single American was ever tried for treason, for helping Hitler before, during, and after the war, when they smuggled the Nazi money in. And I think part of it was the Dulles brothers designed an uncentralized intelligence system for America after World War II, so no one could ever put all the pieces together to indict their clients for their financial collaboration with the Nazis or the Bolsheviks. And we actually had 22 different American intelligence agencies after World War II. And the Dulles brothers invented stovepiping. You couldn't just call the guy in the agency next to you. You had to send it all the way up your chain of command to your boss, and he would send it over to the top of their agency and would work all its way down. So there was lots of opportunities to make sure that investigations got killed. So that's what stovepiping was intended to do, was to prevent the sharing of intelligence. Well, you know, they discovered that many of the Nazis had been assigned to prosecute were on the CIA payroll. See, I didn't have a clue, because these guys had come in from the State Department with phony biographies. And, you know, but it was really an enormous scandal, because it showed that the Attorney General of the United States had disobeyed President Truman and had personally sponsored Nazi war criminals in coming in. So I was threatened with imprisonment if I spoke out. So the way around that was congressional hearings. So I ended up on 60 Minutes and caused a national uproar. Congress demanded congressional hearings. Mike Wallace got the Emmy Award. My family got the death threats. But the congressional hearings, I've now discovered, were fixed. That the Justice Department had gone behind my back and made sure that there was no secret session, no executive session, where I could discuss the classified files. And I didn't know why. I didn't know at that time that the Arab Nazis, I'd seen all their files, were back on the payroll again. That Vice President Bush, back in 1985, had hired the Arab Nazis to go fight the Russians in Afghanistan. And I didn't know that the Justice Department itself was lying through its teeth to Congress, portraying guys like Mykola Lebed, the head of the Ukrainian version of the Gestapo, were telling Congress that he was the leader of the anti-Nazi resistance. What a horrible lie. So the Justice Department has committed fraud on Congress not once, but twice. And they're going to keep on getting away with it until we put some lawyers in jail. And that's why I wrote the book. I lived long enough to outweigh all the censorship, and the 30-year time barrier expired. Now these guys have to face public inquiry. The idea was that Galen said, I am going to re-recruit all of these guys who collaborated with us in the invasion of Russia and put them to work to set up underground spy cells behind Russian lines. So Galen said, I'm going to recruit all of the former Nazi collaborators of Eastern Europe and put them back on my payroll. Just give me money and I'll take care of everything. And the Dulles brothers said, sure, what the heck. The Dulles brothers really didn't care about Galen. All they cared about was that it was a perfect cover for national security, a blanket to throw over their corporate clients' collaboration with the Third Reich. So Galen was just a useful cover story to them. And, of course, Galen was totally incompetent. If he'd been any good, the Germans would have won the war on the Eastern Front. But because of Galen, Nazi war criminals were put on the German intelligence payroll, and then the OPC payroll, and then finally the CIA payroll. But at the end, the CIA didn't even know which of their employees were Nazis. That's one of the things I wrote in my new book, was I revealed a memo I had written to the CIA explaining that a lot of their files had been destroyed by OPC. The CIA just didn't know which of their own employees had been previously employed by the Third Reich. Steve Roman was the wealthiest man in Canada. He was Richard Nixon's partner in the uranium mines up in Canada. And Roman found out that I was working with Canadian Broadcasting Corporation on a documentary about the Pope's visit to Canada. But we were watching the Pope filming the Pope dedicating a new Slovakian cathedral in Canada, and we were zeroing in all the Nazi war criminals in the audience. It was a real scandal. So Roman, being a Slovakian, wanted the whole thing canceled, and he threatened to tie up CBC with years of litigation and wreck their budget. They're like their equivalent of, you know, NPR. And the cowardly Canadians backed down, and the show never aired. A good friend of mine, Claire Regay, she and I has been working on an independent documentary film for the last 5 years, and it's very powerful. It goes through all the declassified documents now showing how America's finest families funded Hitler. And the film will be released next year, and I think it's going to cause an international scandal, because with it will be a website with all the new documents showing exactly how this stuff happened. Now, just last year, all of a sudden, all of Claire's bank accounts were seized by the IRS. No notice, no trial, nothing. And, you know, luckily she had independent funding to get good lawyers, and that nonsense was stopped. But for a while there, we were afraid that the American documentary was going to go the same way as the Canadian documentary, just get, buried. But I think the truth is going to come out.